the last two sessions of today. Our first speaker of the last session is Klaas Landsman from the Radboud University in Nijmegen, world-renowned expert in mathematical physics, and he also devours thick philosophy volumes. Klaas.
Thank you for the introduction. Can you hear me in the back and everywhere? This can be adjusted in many ways. This is okay?
Sounds like it needs to be a little louder.
It should be up, like this.
You're really tall.
Yes. Is this an improvement? Yes? Now go ahead. So it's a great honor to be able to give this talk in honor of Gerard. In fact, we once jointly with some other people applied to a full program, a large subsidy for research in randomness and determinism in the setting of quantum mechanics, and although Gerard was in fact a PI, it was rejected offhand without even refereeing. So that says something about the status of the subject, which is regrettable, except that fortunately philosophers of physics have some more appreciation for it. Having said this, the picture is somewhat ambiguous, so you probably recognize this as one of the pictures released by CERN after the discovery of the Higgs boson in 2012, and so this is one of the pictures from which allegedly the existence of the Higgs was inferred. So that refers to another piece of work by Gerard, who made a decisive contribution to the theory behind this. But there's another way to read the picture, and that's the relevant one, namely that this is the largely random outcome of a collision. So it was in the context of collision theory that Max Born initially introduced the probability interpretation of quantum mechanics, and that's the way I look at the picture. And that will be the theme of the talk. So it will be about randomness in quantum mechanics, and especially about the question what randomness actually means, and if in whatever meaning quantum mechanics is random or not. So I will have three sort of lines of thought, or lines of attack. So one is physics, and as in the black hole information paradox, there are really two points of view that are opposites, and here they are represented by two books, which I recommend. So I should admit that totally random is a pun. But it's written by an author, Jeff Hook, who actually believes that quantum mechanics is random in the sense that we'll try to make precise. And as we all know, Gerard believes that actually nature is deterministic. And so this is a true opposition we have to come to grips with. The second line of attack or language I will use is not so much probability theory, but something called either Kolmogorov complexity, Kolmogorov randomness, algorithmic randomness. These are the two leading books. They're both about 800 pages. And I think that this still should be more known. There have been some uses of algorithmic randomness in physics before. Maybe there are five or six papers, but that is a very, very powerful language. And I'll try to briefly summarize what it is about and what its use is in understanding randomness in quantum mechanics. If any. And then the third piece of attack is philosophy. So then we have mathematics, physics, philosophy, and that's the style in which I want to work, which used to be called natural philosophy. That is what I actually want to do. And I should say that the use of philosophy is not non-committal. I mean, it's serious. It's not just added for entertainment value or because there are many philosophers in the audience. I was seriously influenced in my sort of technical thinking about randomness by philosophy, and especially by sort of a key idea in modern philosophy due to Wittgenstein, namely the notion of family resemblance, to which something has to be added to make it really effective, and this I will do on the next slide. But for those who are not familiar with this this idea, I'll give two what I see as sort of decisive quotes from Wittgenstein. The first one in blue is in fact from what is now called the Blue Book, which was unpublished in his lifetime, which he actually announces in his later idea. And so he says, the idea, this is a translation from German, the idea that in order to get clear about the meaning of a general term, one had to find the common element in all its applications has shackled philosophical investigation. For it has not only led to no results, but also made the philosopher dismiss as irrelevant the concrete cases which alone could have helped him to understand the usage of the general term. And this, I would say, is also a mistake that had been made about randomness. And then he makes his real point much later in the philosophical investigations, where he introduces his famous idea of family resemblance. So I recommend that randomness is seen in that way. It's not one of his examples, though. I'm saying that these phenomena have no one thing in common in virtue of which we use the same words for all. But there are many kinds of affinity between them. We see a complicated network of similarities overlapping and crisscrossing, similarities in the large and in the small. I can think of no better expression to characterize these similarities than family resemblances. For the various resemblances between members of a family, build, features, color of eyes, gait, temperaments, and so on and so forth, overlap and crisscross in the same way. But you have to add a point to this, which is that if randomness is seen as a family resemblance, then its various different, partly overlapping, crisscrossing meanings are actually all, and really, as far as I'm aware, this is true without exception from antiquity to the present, like quantum theory, they're all defined negatively. And so this was true from the beginning. So Aristotle was probably the first author to comment on randomness using various terminology. He used accidents, effects. And so in Aristotle, in the examples and the analysis he gives, it's always related to failure of purpose, which is part of his sort of teleological worldview. The two examples, which are well known, is that a man goes to the market and meets. So in order to buy food, that actually needs his debtor, who of course he did not want to meet, but that was not his purpose in going to the market, which was to buy food, and that makes it an accident in the Aristotelian sense. And then the other example is that a man digs a hole in his garden to plant a tree, but he finds a treasure. But that was unintended, that's not the final cause. Strangely enough, the atomic world proposed by Democritus was seen by Aristotle as purposeless. This in itself is not strange, it fits into the Aristotelian picture. But Epicurus, as represented by Lucretius, actually found the atomic world, the deterministic atomic world, not random at all. And that's why Epicurus added this famous swerve. So again, in this context of defining randomness through its antipole or in a negative way, so the randomness of the swerve is because particles depart from their natural straight Aristotelian course. That's his notion of randomness, completely different from the one of Aristotle. And as you know, this was introduced in order to create room for free will. Now, this is one of my two famous, my two favorite paintings. And I would say, when I saw it for the first time, that this is the representation of the swerve. And so if anything is an attempt to paint randomness, it's that. And especially if you add to the reputation of Jackson Pollock as someone who was usually drunk, like our Carl Apple just threw paint to the wall, that confirms that this should be sort of a random painting, but that is not true at all. So there is a very interesting short movie called Pollock Painting, which is even on YouTube, and it's the opposite. So he's very careful. So firstly, the canvas is on the ground, so he doesn't throw paint to the wall, he lets it drip. But you see him walk around, and he looks very carefully, and then there's one just droplet of paint, and then he walks back, and it's all very considerate. And he actually says, so I can control the flow of the paint, there is no accident. And this is an illustration of the fact that randomness is illusive in a way that I will make highly technical, so there won't only be pictures of it all. There will be some math, but I won't make this technical, but the idea that randomness is illusive is already clear from the beginning. So if you take this Pollock painting, the previous one, which looks pretty random to me, but in fact is not random at all, and compare it to the CERN picture, which in fact looks pretty regular to me, but in fact allegedly expresses the ultimate randomness in nature, then you're fooled. So I actually own a painting I could afford. So this one is I bought it from a fellow student called Lahai, who became actually an artist. So we both studied physics at the same time. I went on and he became an artist. And also here, one of the reasons I liked it was that it looked very random to me. I said, no, this is a group of dancing people. And he even identified me and said, this was his girlfriend. So then you're easily fooled by randomness. All right, so to continue this sort of philosophical analysis of randomness as a negatively defined family resemblance, the meaning of randomness that I think people like Gerard deny, I think is scholastic or medieval, with due respect, taken into secular context by none other than Spinoza, Laplace, and also Einstein, which is what Spinoza in the Ethics expressed as a randomness at the sanctuary of ignorance. So in Dutch, toeval is een toevluchtsoord van de onwetendheid. So it's again defined negatively, it's defined as ignorant, and that is the dominant use, I think, still. And there's one quotation instead of the famous one by Laplace, which also is meant to express this. I found something by a follower of Newton called Arbuth Noah, who translated the first mathematical text on chance by Huygens, written in Latin. He translated it into English. And, so in the preface, he wrote something that really, I think, catches what Spinoza and Gerard mean. So it is impossible for a die with such determined force and direction not to fall on such determined sides. Only I don't know the force and direction which makes it fall on such determined sides. And therefore I call it chance, which is nothing but the bond of art. Then Leibniz comes with, again, a completely different, though still negatively defined meaning of randomness, which is the absence of a determining cause. And that's what people who believe in randomness in quantum mechanics actually claim to be the case. And which possibility Leibniz, although he stated it sort of not as a possibility because he didn't believe in it, but he stated it as a non-possibility, so to speak. Because Leibniz believed in the principle of sufficient reason, and he expresses this in many ways, but for example, he says everything proceeds mathematically, actually meant logically, that is infallibly in the whole wide world. So it's not something that Leibniz, in fact, himself believed, but that's what the party line quantum mechanics people claim. And so I move on. And then it will slowly become more serious, more mathematical, to what I see as really a great quote. So as you know, Born was the first person, at least in a published paper, to claim that quantum mechanics had a certain random effect, or so he specifically argued that the outcome of collisions was random. And he didn't only put this in print as the first person, although apparently in correspondence between Pauli, Heisenberg, Bohr, and Born, this idea was already floating. So it's probably not originally due to Born. But he wrote it down, and he wrote more than that. So I would say that he also said the right things about it. So since I'm very pleased that there are so many students and other young people, I think the old people will know this, but I still felt it's sensible to read it. Because he really makes all the major points, again, in the very first paper on the subject. So thus Schrödinger's, again, it's translated from German, thus Schrödinger's quantum mechanics gives a very definite answer to the question of the outcome of a collision. However, this does not involve any causal relationship. One obtains no answer to the question, what is the state after the collision, but only to the question, how probable is the specific outcome of the collision, for which he gives his famous Born rule for the probability. This raises the entire problem of determinism. From the standpoint of our quantum mechanics, there's no quantity that could causally establish the outcome of a collision in each individual case. However, so far, we are not aware of any experimental clue to the effect that there are internal properties of atoms that enforce some particular outcome. Should we hope to discover such properties that determine individual outcomes later? I myself tend to relinquish determinism in the atomic world, but it is also a philosophical question for which physical arguments alone are not decisive. So he solved even that. Very well done. Okay, now, so the question that will dominate the rest of the talk, and I could say, is the topic, namely, which sort of randomness is actually meant here? So I've already tried to argue that in all cases, randomness is the family resemblance is defined through its antipoles, defined negatively. And this is even true within quantum mechanics. So quantum mechanics is rich enough to be home to its own family resemblance kind of randomness. There are various different meanings of randomness even within the context of quantum theory. And before turning to those, I would first have to agree what sort of randomness we mean, because as you all know, the Schrödinger equation is deterministic. It's even more deterministic than Newton's laws in a mathematical sense. And so what we agree with Born is that randomness applies to outcomes of measurements. This talk is not about the measurement problem. We just assume that measurements are well-defined procedures in laboratories and have outcomes, and we exclusively study sequence of outcomes, typically of binary measurements, yes-no questions, with 50-50 Born probabilities. So that is the object, so you can just think of them as finite or infinite strings of zeros and ones coming out of a quantum random number generator, if you like, and it's about the randomness of those that the talk will be. And the only complication that might play a role is that there isn't one such string, but two in the EPR, or Bell kind of setting. And then it's in that context that there are still various notions of randomness, and the one that Born, I think, clearly meant is that a randomness is the antipole to determinism. So he would claim that quantum theory is indeterministic in precisely that sense. And that's also the notion adopted in no-go theorems like Bell's theorem, the free will theorem, and related results, which can all be read in many different ways. But one way to read these, or construe, as philosophers say, construe these theorems, is that they give sort of constraints on determinism. So they state, well, if you assume that a deterministic hidden variable theory underneath quantum mechanics is possible, then you have to sacrifice such and such. And the two great things you have to sacrifice are either signal locality, or sometimes called parameter independence. So you have to admit that there's one choice to satisfy these theorems, that to admit that if you were to know the hidden variable, you can signal superluminally. And the other sacrifice you can make is to give up free will. And it's the first choice that's typically made by the Bohmians, and the second by Hooft, where I have to notice that, historically speaking, the fact that this is a possibility at all took a while to be understood. So that there was a time that I think Gerard's work and similar proposals were seen as logically refuted by these no-go theorems. It's partly due to this persistence, also partly due to the free will theorem, where Cochin and Conway contributed nothing, I think, mathematically, except the emphasis on the assumption of free will, if you have to make that. So this is now clear. This is the bifurcation or the dichotomy. So if you want a hidden variable theory compatible with quantum mechanics in its statistical predictions as given by the Born rule, you have to give up either hidden signal locality or free will, or maybe even both. But this is only one antipole through which randomness can be defined, determinism. There's a much finer one, I would say, which is this notion of algorithmic randomness, which I would like to introduce with some care, because this point is not well known, although it could be in all courses of probability theory, even for first years. And so the problem with probability theory, and this was already noted by Laplace, and I could have given quotes by Laplace, it was also reanalyzed by people like Kolmesis and Kolmogorov. In fact, it was Kolmogorov who saw the way out. But this is a well-known problem, and that's the problem is that, in fact, if you just use probability theory as the mathematical language for randomness, you don't really capture individual outcomes well in many cases. So in our case, where we just think of a fair coin flip, so 50-50 Bernoulli process, either originating in quantum mechanics or classically. And then you get a new probability measure on the space of outcome sequences, either finite or infinite. And then the point is that every single outcome has the same probability. So if it's a string of length n, the outcome has probability 2 to the minus n, and if it's an infinite string, then the probability will be zero for every outcome. Whereas intuitively, outcomes fall really into different classes. So if you look at this, this will be a very strange outcome of a fair coin flip, and this will be a much more natural outcome. But you cannot distinguish them probabilistically, because they both have the same probability, which is very low. Now, there would be one sort of step forward, which is to add higher sort of regularity properties. And these are called by mathematics problems called the Morel normality. So you can require of a string that it has not only an even distribution of zero and ones, but also of pairs of digits, triples of digits, and so on. And it's slightly easier to give the examples in base 10 rather than base 2, but that's just a matter of presentation. So Borel normality would seem, so again, the even distribution of any conceivable number and group of digits, that would seem to be pretty good. If that's even, then it must be pretty random. But that again is easily refuted by many counterexamples, of which I give two. So the first one is a number actually first written down by students, Chankernow, who also in the 1930s, who in fact proved that it is Borel random, a Borel normal. And in fact, it's one of the few numbers for which you can prove this. It's very hard to prove. So he just wrote down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 9, 10, 11, etc. He just writes down all the numbers in consecutive order. And then it satisfies this distribution. Well, all the digits and all the groups of digits are equally probable in every conceivable order. But it isn't really random, because you can give a prescription for writing it down. So either this Borel normality doesn't capture random as well. Another number is pi. So this is part of the digital decimal expansion of pi. And this has not been proved. I mean, you could almost win the Fields Medal, I think, for proving it Borel normal, but it's certainly be verified numerically to be Borel normal in tens of billions of digits. But again, if you look at this from that point of view, it looks incredibly random. However, is it not? Because you can give a four-line formula that generates it. So in a way, it's also extremely deterministic. And that sort of clash is resolved by the theory of algorithmic randomness at a cost. So this in itself would take about an hour to explain very carefully, so I'll give a very coarse definition of what this technical bond randomness, that's the same as algorithmic randomness. There's also two randomness, three randomness. These are even stronger notions we could talk about later, but not during the talk. And so there are three equivalent ways that look really different to characterize this algorithmic randomness. And one of the reasons that mathematicians actually like this is that these are really different definitions coming to the same conclusion. So they characterize exactly the same property. This is always nice. And in view of the general philosophy that randomness is a family resemblance defined always negatively, they're also defined negatively. So one, the first, I think, most obvious characterization due to Kolmogorov is incompressibility. So you could say that a long binary number is random if there is no lossless compression. And technically, this is expressed in terms of the so-called Kolmogorov complexity, k of x. So k of x is the length of the shortest program run technically on a fixed universal prefix Turing machine that can compute x. And so a number is random in this sense if the length of that program is approximately the length of x itself, which actually means that you simply have to feed x into the computer and just say print x, and you have achieved nothing. But it's a nice characterization. So randomness means incompressibility. Another meaning of randomness is unpredictability, but done in a very, very careful way, defined in recursion theory or computability theory. And the final one is patternlessness. That comes close to Borel normality, but in fact a much, much stronger property. And so I didn't even have precision enough in these definitions to distinguish between finite and infinite sequences. But each can be defined to be random in that sense. It applies to either finite but very long sequences or infinite sequences. These definitions are compatible in a certain way. And you get, I hope, the right picture from these three characterizations. Again, they're all negative. And so in mathematics, that's what we really want. So if we want a number to be random, this is what we actually mean. And this is far, far stronger than being indeterministic. Now, before I apply this to quantum mechanics and to the Born rule, I give some sort of consequences of the definition. It also show that it's a bit strange and that randomness remains elusive even if carefully defined, which for me is very attractive. I mean, I like unclarity in the context of precision. Right, so one good and immediate side of this definition is that each infinite one random string, so algorithmically random according to these definitions, is automatically Borel normal. So all these statistical tests that you think of, they are all satisfied. And not with probability one, they are satisfied by any given random string in this sense. It's also non-computable, so maybe it's not something everyone is familiar with, but if you have functions, say from the natural numbers to the natural numbers, or from the natural numbers to the bit, the 0-1 set with two elements, and there is a notion of computability, and certainly the overwhelming number of functions will not be computable. Only a countable set of functions is in fact computable, and that's a well-defined notion in what's called recursion theory. And most of the compute of the functions we see in mathematics and in daily life are in fact computable, although there are a minority, so to speak. The overwhelming number of functions are in fact non-computable. And that's really where the originality lies. And so each random string is both Borel normal and non-computable, and that makes randomness in this sense far, far stronger than indeterminism, although in order to technically really say this, we have to identify non-computability with indeterminism, which is something we could discuss. This is not necessary for the argument of getting the right feeling. Another point is that each infinite random string contains any finite string infinitely often. This is something that has been known for a long time, but not precisely in this context. So there's something you could call the monkey theorem or the infinite monkey typewriter theorem, which is about the probability that a monkey will type the collected works of Shakespeare. This probability is positive. But this is actually a certainty theorem. So it's not a probabilistic statement. If I would have a random string that is infinite in this sense, then it will, with certainty, contain the collected papers of het hoofd, of Shakespeare, and also of many lesser figures, unfortunately. There's also something called the Boltzmann brain argument, which you can actually prove in this way. Strangely enough, and here we are getting on to sort of quagmire, that almost all random strings that are in fact random, that are truly random, they cannot be proved to be random. So this was discovered by Chaitin, a computer scientist. This is often called Chaitin's incompleteness theorem. It's of Gödelian class, so it actually gives examples of incompleteness in the sense of Gödel, where you have mathematical sentences or statements that are true by a certain kind of reasoning outside the formal system in which you would like to prove it to be true. And that makes randomness elusive, especially in connection with what I'm going to say next. Let's go to the last point first. That in a 50-50 Bernoulli process, which is an infinite sequence of coin tosses, you can actually prove that this is not easy, but this is a major point for my talk, in fact. In fact, infinite strings are random in the sense with probability one, or almost surely in the sense of probability theory, with respect to the canonical measure on a set of infinite sequences. So you could say that there are many, many random strings, but there's only about one plus cousins about which it can be proved that they're random. So that's this try this number omega called the halting probability, which I will not go into, but there's only one infinite string plus the derivatives from which it actually can be proved that it is random, and all the rest, although we know that they are there in overwhelming majority. If I would give you one, you, Fields Medalist in Mathematics, would not be able to prove that they're random. And this can drive you crazy if you stay on this slide, so let's move on and go to the real point, which is randomness and quantum mechanics. And now the analysis becomes increasingly subtle, so the fun with the paintings is over now. So, firstly, to look at the Born rule, that's an uninterpreted single case probability, in my view. So it's just a mathematical expression on the outcome space of the spectrum of an operator, which can be binary, if you measure Pauli matrix, for example. And that is about a single measurement. And if you then pass on to measurement runs, there's a remarkable fact, which I think is known to the Q-Bism people, the quantum Bayesian people. I also proved it in my book, Foundation of Quantum Mechanics, which is not at all a trivial fact, that if you have a run, it doesn't matter whether you describe the entire run quantum mechanically and then take the result, or whether you describe each experiment quantum mechanically and then combine the independent experiments classically. So either way you get a Bernoulli process. So if you simply take the 50-50 coin flip, quantum coin flip, and you can describe it in various ways, but they all come down to the same thing, namely as a Bernoulli process. And the entire analysis I will give, in what time is left to me, is based on the following subtlety, and namely the distinction between properties of outcome sequences that actually happen with probability 1 and properties that happen with probability 0 but are possible. And here you may worry, especially philosophers, that everything I will say will be only about probability 1 or probability 0, and it will be about infinite strings. And so this is clearly an idealization. However, as some of you know, I'm a fan of Erman's principle, which I couldn't put on the slides, fall off, but I'll read it aloud, and I think everyone should know and support it. So Erman's principle says, while idealizations are useful and perhaps even essential to progress in physics, a sound principle of interpretation would seem to be that no effect can be counted as a genuine physical effect if it disappears when the idealizations are removed. So the idealization means having infinite strings, and I can guarantee you, although I will not explain it in this talk, that what I will tell you satisfies Erman's principle. So a high probability, probability 1 for infinite strings, will be high probability for finite strings, and strictly zero probability for infinite strings will be very low, but positive probability for finite strings. So this is satisfied, but I will not explain that this is the case. It needs estimates beyond the context of this talk. Okay, I'm writing a paper in which you dedicated to queer academia to be submitted to the studies, not the foundations of physics, but also the studies. Okay, so this is too philosophical for the foundation. Where's Carlo? Is he? Yeah. Okay, so now you get the following thing. So on the one hand, outcomes of infinite runs are one random almost surely. So that's the theorem on the previous slide, which is general. It has nothing to do with quantum mechanics, but this is a consequence. On the other hand, you cannot prove that any given individual sequence, with this one exception, omega, should you ever find it by measurement, is one random, even if it is random, so that is strange. And also, there's a converse to this, that the one randomness of an outcome, and again, an outcome is a single, infinite, or if you like, very long sequence of zeros and ones coming from a measurement. The one randomness of outcome, in fact, implies that if you extract the single case probability in the old-fashioned way, namely as a relative frequency, as people like von Mises wanted to have it, then you do, in fact, recover the single case Born probabilities from which the whole analysis started. However, this is only true almost surely, namely with probability 1. So there will be many, many outcome sequences, even uncountably many, for which you do not recover the single case probability, for example, the Born probability. And this is crucial for the rest. So there's always a tension. A lot of things go well. So most of these sequences, you can say, are random in the right sense, and their relative frequencies recover the single case probability, but many are not also. So there's war and there's peace. And you have to deal with both. And so one consequence is, if you seriously ask yourself, what actually about these sequences with low probability? So zero probability in this idealized case, low probability in practice. Now, I'm certainly not the first one to use this sort of this language of algorithmic randomness. There are four or five papers, of which the most interesting by far, I think, although it's flawed, is by a guy called Jurtsever, who also worked on the problems discussed in Horning. So he also worked on black holes and Hawking radiation. He left the scene in around 2000 and works in industry now. But he wrote, I would say, the single most interesting paper on the interaction between algorithmic randomness and quantum mechanics. And what he tried to prove is that if an outcome sequence in the usual, the bipartite, the EPR Bohm-Bell setting, reviewed by Jos very kindly two talks ago, is not one random, then it emits superluminal signaling. So I asked, in fact, a large number of people to look at the proof, and I also looked at it myself, and none of us could understand it. Then I contacted him by LinkedIn. And so he actually replied very kindly, and so he said that he had never followed it up, and he agreed with the criticism. And I also think what he was after cannot be proved, because the assumption is too weak. So what you actually should have proved, and I got there just through him, so to speak, by reading what he intended to do in vain. So you have to do justice to the difference between, as I just said, the zero probability difference between the Born probability of the single case and the long run frequency. So you don't always recover the Born probability. And so what you can show, and that's actually quite easy, is that in this typical Alice and Bob notation, so psi is the quantum state, it's like a EPR correlated or a Bell state. X is the outcome at the side of Alice, predicated on settings A of Alice and B of Bob. And then the no signaling axiom or property of quantum mechanics will be that this is independent of B. But this is not what you necessarily recover as a probability independent of B. So there will be many outcome sequences in which it is, in fact, depends on B. Although for infinite strings, these have zero probability, and for finite strings, low probability, they exist. And from those, you can actually signal by basically following what Jurtsever tried to do under an assumption that was too weak to achieve his goal. And so that brought me to the conclusion, which I think is obvious, and many people I'm sure have proposed this, that the no-signaling property of nature is a statistical law, like the second law of thermodynamics. So it holds with high probability that you can actually devise scenarios that violate it. And so the reason this works is that the assumption I use is actually stronger than Jurtsever's. And something that's not part of the argument that helps perhaps understanding it is that what is going on here sort of reverts the logic of, well, the Bell's theorem or the logic of PR boxes, which logic is, if you axiomatize the hidden variable theory that there is no hidden signaling plus free will, then determinism, sorry, then the theory cannot exist, so the theory cannot be deterministic and hence the theory must show randomness. If you take the contrapositive and just, let's say, assume free will for free rights, just for the sake of argument, then what you get is that, in fact, no randomness implies signaling. So it's basically the same logic, but interpreted in a different way, because in Bell and so on, these are properties about hidden variable theories, and in my case, the properties of outcome sequences, which are different things. But the logical argument is very, very similar. And so this, in a way, is not surprising at all. And I think it is remarkable and it should be known. It's a consequence of probability theory, randomness theory, and the recognition that there are events of low probability. And then adds the whole Alice, Bob, Bell, free will stuff, and you get this. The last technical thing, and then I'll wrap up, I would like to say, is about the impossibility of deterministic hidden variable theories compatible with the Born rule. So just to warm up, this is the last technical slide of all of that, but I would like to warm up for this slide alone. So if you take the Bohmians and at Hoft as sort of proposers of hidden variable theories that are deterministic and have to make a sacrifice, so as I said, the Bohmian sacrifice hidden signal locality, Gerhard sacrifices free will or free choice. And in any case, they all need a probability measure on the space of hidden states in order to recover the Born rule. So the goal of all these theories is not just to be deterministic, be about some other universe, they're supposed to reproduce the prediction of quantum mechanics. And so that's done through a probability measure, which is very straightforward either way. So for the Bohmians, the hidden variable is just x, its position, and this probability measure, so dictated by the quantum state psi, it is simply what I would call the standard of Pauli or Born probability distribution for position, called the quantum equilibrium condition in Bohmian mechanics. In case of Hoft, at least in the simpler versions of his theory, the hidden variable is just labeled of an orthonormal basis in Hilbert space. And then if you expand the vector, the wave function psi, in that basis, you get coefficients. And then the probability measure required to recover quantum mechanics, at least statistically, is simply the Born probability Cn squared. So it's completely straightforward. And you can also say that it's the same in Bohmian mechanics in Hoft's case. However, if you now look closely at the relationship between this probability measure as a mathematical construction, like the Born measure, and the fact that in experimental physics you actually have to sample this measure by repeated experiments, then you get into trouble. So what you need to do, or what you need to know, is assign to run n of some experiments, so measurement number n in a run, you need to assign the hidden variable that controls the situation at that moment in that run. And then there are two possibilities. Either you could ask the hidden variable theory to provide the sampling. That's, I think, what the real determinist would want to do, because the alternative is that if the hidden variable theory does not provide the sampling, it will only give average, it's almost no improvement on quantum mechanics. It just gives statistical predictions without individual predictions, whereas I would say the goal of determinism is to give individual predictions. So I think it should be option one. But then again, if you provide the sampling in a deterministic theory insofar as these hidden states determine the outcome for a given one, then I would say the sampling itself must be deterministic. And this is incompatible with the Born rule. Since once you actually accept that you have to introduce this probability measure, you again fall into the trap of a Bernoulli process, with the consequence that the outcomes will be one random with probability one, and that is impossible by any kind of deterministic sampling. So this I will explain more clearly in my paper, but the conclusion is that deterministic hidden variable theory, either Bohm's theory or Hoft's theory, cannot, strictly speaking, reproduce the Born rule. And to explain, well, this is the last technical slide, I forgot I had it. To explain this in a sort of daily life context, but it's exactly the same situation in a way. If you take coin tossing, then as I think most people know, coin tossing is a deterministic process, although this is still under analysis, so probability theorists still write papers about coin tossing, but a simplified way of looking at it is that it's a deterministic process, so it's only Laplacian random. We perceive it as random because we don't know the initial conditions. The initial conditions are the vertical velocity of the throw, of the toss, plus the angular momentum of the coin. And if you were to know them, you would be able to predict the outcome. But as a matter of fact, if you go high up in phase space, meaning high velocity and high rotation, it becomes increasingly sensitive on the initial conditions. Now, if you start with the idea that this is a 50-50 Bernoulli process, as every group of probability theory does on page one, that effect, you can only recover that fact from the physics if, as on the previous slides, the sampling, which means that for cost number n, you specify the initial conditions, namely the vertical velocity and the angular momentum, is random in the sense of this one randomness. If it's ever so deterministic, you will not reproduce the probability theory of a Bernoulli process. And it's very similar. So I would say you can't eat your cake and have it. That's how the Unabomber was called. Because most people say you can't eat your cake and have it. So most people say you can't have your cake and eat it, I think. But he wrote in his manifesto, you can't eat your cake and have it. And his brother recognized that Bernoulli was called. Okay, so you can't eat your cake and have it. You cannot both have a deterministic underpinning in which also the sampling is deterministic, and a Bernoulli process. And the Born rule axiomatizes it. Once you accept the Born rule and this theorem that combining experiments actually can be done classically, you have a contradiction. So my advice is that you have to choose between determinism and the Born rule. I guess the choice of both parties is clear, but it's a delicate choice. Right, so this contradiction between these two books, which again I both recommend, is very real. I mean, it's not just a matter of window dressing. Either the totally random people have to give up total randomness in the sense of the Born rule, or the determinists will have to give up reproducing the Born rule. And in fact, the conclusion of these people, I forgot to say this, so the acronyms. So he did experiments also in a casino with roulette, but also with coin flipping. And the conclusion is that numerically speaking, this is not a 50-50 Bernoulli process. So the sampling is in fact deterministic in real life, and hence it cannot be a Bernoulli process, as they found. Okay, so I'm at the end of my talk. There are two. I would like to give a brief conclusion, and then I have a present. So. To get back to the beginning, randomness is a very difficult concept, but at least I, and hopefully other people, understand it much better once you recognize that it's not a uniform single thing. It's a family resemblance of a very special kind, namely in the sense that the various different meanings of randomness are defined through their antipoles, they're defined in the negative. And that's true even within quantum mechanics, so that's rich enough so that you still have a family of meanings defined negatively. And the relevant ones, at least in this sort of discussion of randomness in quantum mechanics, are on the one hand determinism, that's from Born, and the no-go theorems actually assume as the antipole. And the other one is compressibility of the outcome sequence of measurements, and that would be what defines this algorithmic or one randomness. And so this one randomness is far stronger than in determinism, but it's sort of difficult because you cannot prove it. So everybody look at it, you lose. A careful study of one randomness, which I had to do in 10 minutes, but it can be done more carefully. So if you study really what it means to have one randomness as a prediction of a Bernoulli process, if you think about the Born rule, if you do the mathematics of log measurements runs and think about low probability events, then you will come to the conclusion that no signaling is just a statistical law. Finiteness of the speed of light, if you like. Then the last point was that determinism, in my view, should not only mean that the hidden state determines each measurement outcome, and in the case of Beethoven, also the setting of each measurement, with the Bohmian leaf free, but it also should mean that the sampling map should be non-random. So n again is the number n, experiment number n. The sampling map associated to experiment number n, the hidden state controlling that run. And I would say a determinist must say that this must be determined and not random. And then you get a contradiction with the Born rule. And that makes it impossible to recover the Born measure from relative frequencies. And so, again, deterministic hidden variable theories defeats the Born rule, if ever so slightly, but you can never get it exactly. Okay, so I would like to recommend one book, which is this one. This has just come out. So it is by Diaconis and Skirms, called 10 Great Ideas About Chance, Princeton University Press. It is incredibly good, both about Bohr and Corning tossing, about quantum mechanics, about algorithmic randomness, which they explain much better than I could do in this slide. It's a fantastic book. And then maybe not such good books, but which I would like to give to Gerard as a present, which you don't have to work anymore, you're retired. And hope I didn't forget them. So. Well done, and thanks for being so inspirational. Please.
Okay, who can I give Jim?
Thank you very much for the wonderful talk, Klaus, in every way. Of the many things to discuss or ask, may I select just one? It's about the second slide on the no signaling, the randomness in quantum two. If I understand the gist of this, it reminds me of John Bell with his skepticism about the parameter independence contrasted with the outcome independence in the terminology of Shimoni. So almost everybody here will know this jargon, but roughly outcome is result and parameter is an unfortunate word for setting or choice of what quantity to measure. And we all tend to be more tolerant of local affairs being dependent upon a distant outcome than we are tolerant of their depending upon a distant human choice of parameter or setting. And as I think of Bell, he's saying in his late work, why should nature care concerning the factualness of something, whether it's a human choice or some micro fact? And your blue statement seems to me a bit Bellian in that way.
The middle one.
Yeah, the blue middle statement. Because it is along the lines of, as I invite comment, you know.
So I don't claim novelty of the conclusion, except that reaching it through the study of outcome sequences is one way to get there, and that is, I think, not in Bell.
I completely agree, not in Bell, but I felt that his doubt about Shimoni's contrast is made a bit more precise.
Yeah, but this is done in the setting of deterministic theories already.
Yeah.
So outcome independence is not an issue here. It's only about parameter and does that
right.
Sort
right.
Of
thank you.
Now here it was also you were simultaneous in our reference frame.
As this ideas come new to me, so I was very impressed by all that. But there's one thing I'm confused, and I would like you to dispel my confusion. I found attention with the two things you said. One being your main argument, which I think I understood, which concerns the randomness or the one randomness of the lambda n. On the other hand, what you said about idealized systems, which are only relevant if the same result holds when you go away from the idealization. So the question is that this strict alternative that you're including there, which is very strong and convincing, couldn't be attenuated by requiring that the distribution on the lambdas is not really one random, but somehow a little bit less random, agreeing. I don't know if I made.
No, this is a very good question. If I understand it well, so you're actually, well, I would call trying to find a loophole in the actual idealization that I use. So if I understand you correctly, say if I drop the idealization and I look at finite strings as outcome of repeated measurements, And in fact, since the definition of one randomness is not so absolute, there is some maneuvering space.
Exactly.
And this is a good point, which I have to address. So that's why I'm not sure of Erwin's principle, and I haven't thought of it.
Okay.
That's right, but that's okay, to be continued and with acknowledgement. But I doubt it. So there is enormous continuity between the analysis of finite long strings and infinite strings insofar as these randomness properties are concerned. But this is sort of the whole point. Is the same thing I haven't looked at in that sense, and you're right. So maybe this is the loophole for the determinist. Thanks.
Okay,
well, that's
okay,
I have a question too.
Could you move back to the book recommendation?
Well, which one? Let's do this one.
This one, or the next one?
Right, oh.
I just want a remark in my way of looking at quantum mechanics. Boltzmann follows sort of trivially in the following way. Imagine that you have a planetary system, a couple of planets, and you know exactly the masses of the planets, you know exactly the mass of the sun, you know exactly how to deal with gravity. There still will be uncertainties in the outcome of your calculation because you do not know the initial state. So there is uncertainty in the initial state, and that reflects in uncertainty in the final state. Classically, I haven't touched on the other yet. Now I say the quantum theory goes the same way. The one probability that I end up with are the uncertainties of the initial state.
Yeah,
and that's because you understand why it is so. You have these orthonormal states which evolve to orthonormal states. If they superposition, you have final results of these superposition as well. With the same coefficients. So those, so whatever the uncertainty of the initial state comes with numbers which add up to one, probabilities you can call them, the same probabilities come in the final state, but mixed up. And so quantum mechanics is essentially just a proof that nature seems to be mixing up things, but it's nothing worse than that. So
well,
if you don't like your mixer, well, you will see correlations, good for you, but eventually it will be too complicated for anybody to tell you this happens. And so, yes,
so this
I
agree about up to. Up to this point. So here I agree, in your approach, this is not even a definition, it's a sort of an outcome of your theory, this choice. But what's your reply to this? So at experiment number n, your theory is supposed to actually give which state n you are in. So the lambda n's are the n's in Gera's view. And who gives this prescription and how is it given?
Imagine you repeat the experiment with the planets many times. Any time you start the planets in a different initial position, you can't control that. Because how do you control the initial state? Well, the planets will be in some state. And you have to work with that.
No, but so you
and
agree this is...
Every time you repeat, you don't know. And
you're...
that lack of knowledge is reflected in a completely...
But then you're in option two. That your theory does not provide a sampling, which is consistent. But I would not call it a completely deterministic theory if you give up the possibility of giving the initial conditions of the planets.
Extra thing that could come later is why do we use a number system, the real numbers? The problem is in fundamental nature, I think, in fact, our use of real numbers, which I think. The real numbers require an infinite number of decimal places all the time. That's too much. It's more natural to suspect the nature is based on finite numbers.
Yeah, I agree, and that's compatible with this approach. Everything is based on the natural numbers. It's not in the Bohmian case, but especially in your case, because your hidden states are discrete.
Yes.
They are labeled by the real numbers, if you like. So this also what Shizan is now arguing, that this problem with the real numbers, I agree with. But I'm not sure it's relevant to this dilemma. But do I take it right that you are in number two? You don't provide the initial positions of the planets.
That's right. And I have no way to control. In any quantum experiment, how do you know where all the atoms started off before you began the experiment? You don't. You're just assuming from because you're a very learned person, you think these atoms will be there and there and there, and there will be a distribution. But that distribution will also be a distribution in your final.
No, then you can keep the Born rule.
And that is Born's rule.
Yeah, all right. Maybe that's what the Bohmians would say to them. Thanks.
I'm wondering how much of what you said might rely on thinking about probabilities rather than long-run frequencies. So what, I mean, maybe you can just tell me why you think it might change if you swap to like subjective probabilities and just talk about large numbers of Bayesian updates or something.
Yeah, so I don't make the mistake of defining probabilities by long frequencies. So as I said, they're defined by the Born rule in quantum mechanics, or it's some alternative, but let's say by the Born rule. Then the issue is, in case of a repeated experiment, does the ensuing outcome sequence recover them? And this is a well-defined question which you can answer with probability one by yes. But probability one is, in a way, it leaves out an ocean of probability zero outcomes that do not recover the Born rule. And so this whole stuff about Bayesian and objective versus subjective, it is somewhat orthogonal, I think, to this. So that doesn't seem to satisfy you with this answer.
I was intrigued by the idea that no signaling is a statistical law, but I wondered whether you would say the same thing if you couched this analysis in the context of quantum field theory, where I would have thought no signaling is just sort of built into the structure of the theory in terms of the commutation relations of space-like separated operators.
Yeah, so I think that's a disagreement I would have with people, even in algebraic quantum field theory. So what they call Einstein locality, which is this space-like commutativity property you, I think, refer to, is already taken into account, because the Hilbert spaces of Ellis and Bohm are tensor products. So they already have that. They're combined as a tensor product, so they already have that independence. And I would say the no-signaling property, even in quantum field theory, is not a consequence of what these people, maybe you also call Einstein locality or local commutativity, even if you have that. And as I said, I have it here too, because Ellis and Bohm are, in a way, mathematically in the same situation. The Hilbert space factors into an Ellis and a Bohm part. It's really, that is the non-relativistic version of Einstein locality, and you still have all these problems. So I expect that this goes through also in quantum field theory. And this remains to be shown, but I see no fundamental difference, in fact. So again, local commutativity does not imply no signaling by an analysis like this, which again remains to be given for quantum field theory, but will be very similar, I think.
To follow up separately with you.
See, and either Sean or you seem satisfied with what I'm saying.
Well, time's really up, but I give your last opportunity to ask a question.
Yeah, I will try to. That was a very beautiful talk, but I am slightly puzzled by what sense you give to the word provide here in these two claims for this
dilemma. Right.
In a deterministic theory, or in variable theory, or then in just classical physics, one usually merely assumes that there exists a hidden variable or an initial state such that the later result will be determined by that initial state. One doesn't assume necessarily that you know what the initial state is. That's very explicit, for example, in Laplace's famous quote. We don't know what the initial state is, but if you could give me the initial state, I could calculate everything. So that, I think, will also apply to the sampling rule. In a deterministic theory, there has to exist a sampling rule. But you don't need to know the sampling rule. So if you say you have to provide sampling, does that mean that the theory has to tell you exactly what that rule is? Or does it merely mean that there must exist a sampling rule? but it doesn't.
This is almost the difference between determinism and superdeterminism. But I would say the theory has to be in the theory, because this is so the hidden variables develop in time. There is a dynamics for the hidden states, and so measurements follow each other up in time. So I would say a time-dependent theory should give the value of the hidden variable at the time of measurement number n. However, even if it doesn't, all I'm saying is that in order to rescue the Bernoulli process, the sampling has to be random. And that seems to me against the spirit of a deterministic theory. So even if I don't make the very strong requirement that the theory should actually give this, through its time dependence or its dynamics, I still would say that in any case, this sampling has to contain some random elements, and then the theory is no longer deterministic.
I don't quite see that. You could, as you, I think, yourself explained, you could see the repeated experiment as just one big meta-experiment, and then there is just one initial state. So the dynamics doesn't need to come into play.
Yeah, you could even do the simultaneously, perhaps. Yes. That's an interesting thing I would have to address. But still, if you think that, if you look at the coin tossing case, again, the sampling of associating initial conditions to one number n must be random in order to recover the Bernoulli process, that is, probabilities. And I don't see any way out of that. I mean, the Newtonian dynamics has to provide that. Otherwise, it's not a theory of nature, albeit within classical physics.
I'm not sure I agree with
that. But this may be also even related to the free will, that you seem to want to leave out part of the theory because it's part of the experimental setup. Is that?
I think
I would still call back
to deterministic
theory.
If the choice of the initial state is determined by the experimental setup and not by the theory.
Yeah, but it should not be a semantic discussion, but I really think.
Okay, I think we have to end it here, Jeremy. Sorry. We have to go to the final speaker, Tim Motley. Thanks, class.